Hosting our discussion today is Lindsay Burke. Lindsay serves as our Will Skillman Fellow in Education Policy. She researches and writes on federal and state education issues, focusing on the two critical areas of education policy, reducing the federal role in education and empowering families with school choice. Her commentary, research, and op-eds have appeared in various newspapers and magazines, and she has also been featured on many major television and radio programs. She holds her bachelor's degree in politics from Hollins College and a master of teaching degree in foreign language education from the University of Virginia. Please join me in welcoming Lindsay Burke. Lindsay?
Great. Thank you, Sean. And thank you all for joining us today. We have a really exciting event planned. For many, earning a college degree is the way to climb the ladder of economic mobility. College graduates, on average, earn $650,000 more over the course of their careers than someone with just a high school diploma. Although a college degree isn't the only route to upward mobility, for many, it represents the most promising path for achieving their full earnings potential. The value of earning a college degree is demonstrable. The cost of earning that degree, however, has become prohibitively expensive for many as college costs have risen. Average tuition at four-year public institutions for out-of-state students reached $22,200 last year. And at private universities, average tuition now exceeds $30,000 annually. Many students leave college with a bachelor's degree in hand, but also leave burdened with tens of thousands of dollars in student loan debt. Worse still, many students leave college without graduating, burdened with debt and lacking a paper credential that they had hoped would put them on a path toward middle-class stability or better. Well-intentioned federal policies have failed to drive down college costs. Over the past 10 years, the number of students borrowing through federal student loan programs increased 69%. An easy flow of federal student aid has enabled students to take out sizable student loans with little, if any, credit check or consideration of their future earnings potential. Some folks have even argued that such policies have enabled universities to raise tuition, creating a vicious lending and spending cycle. So what can be done? Congress could soon consider reauthorization of the Higher Education Act. The HEA, which governs all student loans and grants, was last authorized in 2008 and is in dire need of reform. Many titles have outlived their purposes, and the existing law makes it difficult to pursue systemic reform. Most importantly, however, either as part of an HEA reauthorization or as a standalone effort, Congress needs to consider the impact of our ossified accreditation system, which I know our panelist will touch on today. And speaking of our panelists, we have a really stellar lineup of experts with us today. Hank Brown is an attorney with Brownstein, Hyatt, Farber, Schreck, and also leads the Accreditation Reform Initiative for the American Council of Trustees and Alumni. He is the immediate past president of the University of Colorado, and prior to his tenure at Colorado, he represented Colorado in the U.S. Senate and served five consecutive terms in the U.S. House before that. Senator Brown served in the U.S. Navy from 1962 to 1966 and was decorated for his combat service as a forward air controller after volunteering for duty in Vietnam. Ann Neal is co-founder and president of the American Council for Trustees and Alumni. In 2007 and again in 2010, Ms. Neal was appointed to the National Advisory Committee on Institutional Quality and Integrity. It's quite a mouthful, but I think we'll probably hear more about that today. It advises the U.S. Secretary of Education on federal accreditation. She has testified before the U.S. Congress and before state legislatures. Prior to joining ACTA, Ms. Neal served as the General Counsel and Congressional Liaison for National Endowment for the Humanities. She also worked as a First Amendment and communications lawyer for Rogers and Wells and Wiley, Rhine and Fielding. Ms. Neal graduated Phi Beta Kappa and magna cum laude from Harvard, and she received her JD from Harvard Law School, where she was president of the Harvard Journal on Legislation. She also holds an honorary doctorate from Colorado Christian University. She's served on the boards of many cultural and civic organizations and currently is director of the Mount Vernon Ladies Association and Alexander Hamilton Institute. Neil McCluskey is the associate director of Cato's Center for Educational Freedom. Prior to arriving at the Cato Institute, McCluskey served in the U.S. Army, taught high school English, and was a freelance reporter covering municipal government and education in suburban New Jersey. McCluskey is the author of the book Feds in the Classroom, How Big Government Corrupts, Cripples, and Compromises American Education, and his writings have appeared in such publications as the Wall Street Journal, the Baltimore Sun, and Forbes. In addition to his written work, McCluskey has appeared on C-SPAN, CNN, Fox News, and a host of other television and radio programs. McCluskey holds an undergraduate degree from Georgetown University, where he double majored in government and English, and has a master's degree in political science from Rutgers University and a PhD in public policy from George Mason University. Please join me in welcoming our panelists.
Lindsay, thank you for that wonderful introduction. What a treat to share some thoughts with you all today. And my hope is that we'll stimulate some comments and questions as well as a short talk from each one of us. We love our universities, not just when they win football games, but when they lose as well. We have an affection that goes very deeply. And while they're subject to criticism, they're also the recipient of literally billions of dollars of donated funds every year from Americans. It's part of the affection and the reverence for it. I'm often reminded of that line from the Neil Simon play, Biloxi Blues. I don't know if any of you remember the fade-out scene that they did in the movie that they did, but as the fade-out going over Biloxi, he recalls his time in Biloxi with such fondness, and he pauses and he says, I don't know why there's such pleasant memories, because some awful things happened there. The only thing I can think is I was young at the time we went through it. And that maybe sums up a little of our thinking about universities and our college experience. Lindsay, I am still looking for that $650,000, so if you know where it's at, I'll look for that. But with this pride and with the affection is a reverence for our higher education, and yet we have concerns, and Lindsay did a great job of laying out what some of those concerns are. One of the challenges, at least in my mind, is that universities and colleges find it so difficult to reform, to change, to modernize, to update. It's not that they lack good intentions. It's not that they lack good people. Most of our institutions are blessed with wonderful faculties and great intentions, going from the emotionary to the dreams of improving people's lives. So what's the problem? The problem is accreditation has become a roadblock to reform. It cements in place a system that makes it very difficult for universities and colleges to change and modernize. It cements in place the current ways we do things. So what are the problems? The problems Lindsay outlined, of course, are true. Skyrocketing cost far faster than the rate of inflation. A system that provides degrees in majors that go nowhere at times. That is, majors that don't give you the $650,000 or even a job at the end of the day. A wide range with accreditation of conflicts of interest. That is, the people who do the accrediting are ones themselves who are accredited. They have a built-in conflict of interest that makes an independent objective judgment very difficult. In addition, I think one of the problems that some institutions, certainly not all, but some, is an inability to deal with quality questions. And if you look at the accreditation reports that come in and the accreditation that exams come in, you will find a dearth of information dealing with quality questions. If you're concerned about grade inflation, you find it very difficult to ever see an investigation or an evaluation of it in the accreditation reports. If you're concerned about the quality of courses and the curriculum or the need for modernization, you will look in vain in most accreditation reports to find it. The problem is this: we've created a gatekeeper for federal funds, for student loans, for Pell Grants, and for other assistance. And that gatekeeper is accreditation from one of the many accrediting agencies in the country. The challenge is they're simply not doing the job that will help us control costs, that will help us improve curriculum, that will help us guarantee quality, and a change has to be made. In addition, the process has become incredibly expensive. So what's the solution? Well, happily, you have a bipartisan effort in both the House and the Senate to take a look at this area. And part of what is coming forth is an effort to build on the administration's work with regard to private institutions. That is, they've demanded certain disclosures that seem to indicate some measure, not a total measure, not an adequate measure, but at least some measure of results as you go forward. My hope is we'll see legislation commensurate with the Reauthorization Act that will set up an additional way of accreditation, not barring people from getting accredited as they have in the past, but providing a new way for people who are willing to come up with the right kind of disclosures, ones that help students evaluate the value of the degree and the value of the majors that they go through, one that's far less costly, and one that gives real protection from fraud as we go forward. That new alternative will be one that simply provides an additional avenue for institutions of higher education to be accredited. But the difference will be it will be far less costly, not in the millions that can now take place from some large institutions, that will result in much better disclosure for the students or the potential students that choose to go to the university. And it will also help create an end to the roadblock for reform and improvement of our great institutions. Lindsay, I look forward to our questions and the comments of the panel.
Well, thank you, Hank, and thank you, Heritage, for having us here today. And I want to pick up a bit on Hank's discussion of accreditors as gatekeepers, because I will confess first and foremost that I like accreditors. I mean, the voluntary system of peer review, self-improvement by peers interested in professional responsibility and accountability is a great system. And I think this is an area in which Judith Eaton and I can surely agree. But I think that the problem stems largely, and my premise this morning is, that accreditors as gatekeepers, no, not so good. Now, I cannot tell you how many stories I hear about the time and money, which Hank's already referred to, that institutions are spending on accreditation without any clear payoff to the institution, let alone to the student, parent, or taxpayers. And I think it's frankly time to dial back on the encroachment. The process, as Hank has indicated, has become intrusive, costly, coercive, and damaging to the autonomy of American higher ed. And I am not just concerned about the rights of trustees, although obviously the American Council of Trustees and Alumni does consider those rights very important. But if one believes in shared governance of whatever scope and form, meddling by accreditors undermines that too. So peer review was supposed to be peer review, but that's not what we have now. And I'm not alone in this concern about interference, and I think it really goes back some time to a report called the Columbia Study on Accountability, authored by Patricia Graham, then president of the Spencer Foundation and a professor at Harvard, Richard Lyman, who was president emeritus at Stanford, and Martin Trow. It was supported by Mellon and Columbia, and I think its comments on accountability are as accurate today as they were then. And let me quote from it. "It is time to turn down the volume and exercise restraint in dealing with an enterprise that is so complex and so important to the nation's well-being. An institution can worry less about encroachments on its autonomy if the accrediting agency is not asking about mission and governance, but about its capacity to study itself and improve itself on the basis of what it learns. For accountability to be effective in higher ed, it should, as far as possible, be the responsibility of the academic community, including the trustees. Quite frankly, that's not the system we have now, and it's got to change. The meddling and the intrusion have metastasized, and I wanted to look at just a few recent examples with a range of accreditors. University of Virginia. Say what you will about the firing and rehiring of President Sullivan, The sanctioning of UVA by the accreditor had nothing to do with educational quality. It had everything to do with power politics on campus, and it amounted to nothing less than accreditors second-guessing the Commonwealth and state statutes which give the board plenary authority to hire and fire presidents. Penn State, long after the damage had been done, long after Louis Freeh had issued a voluminous report on the failings of the president and the lack of oversight, long after the board conceded that things had to be changed, middle states came racing in to put Penn State on warning, and then a few months later took them off warning, saying that the trustees had behaved admirably. Anyone looking at recent actions by that board would surely beg to differ. Then there's Tiffin. Here's a school that was trying to survive in a tough marketplace, making online programs available to those least able to pay big tuitions with proven student success. Well, HLC liked it at first, but then when the winds began to blow the other way, it decided it didn't like what it saw, and it began to second guess the board's business decisions. Is that accreditation? Or take Thunderbird, recently in Arizona. There, the peer review team spent days on campus, meeting at great length with every constituency, except the board, to revisit the board's decision to partner with for-profit Laureate after lengthy deliberations, and in clear response to what the accreditors were saying and asking them to do. Then we even have City College of San Francisco. Let me side with the union for a minute. The accreditor has intervened in matters unrelated to academic quality. The auditor in the state has spoken. The special trustee has been appointed. There are state-based democratic processes to deal with this school, and they may not be fast or good, but they exist. And in terms of equity, the graduation rates at City College were good or better than many of those whose accreditation had not been questioned. So my question is, what right do accreditors have to intervene in these governance management issues? They are not elected, they're not accountable to the people, and that's why at one of the recent NASIKI meetings, I voted against the recertification of WASC Junior, because I could not conclude that WASC was a reliable guarantor of educational quality. When we allow accreditors to start making management and financial decisions, when accreditors start training trustees, we have opened up a Pandora's box that will not end well. So all these cases are examples of disturbing accreditor activism and intervention, and examples of how the function and scope of accreditors have expanded exponentially in ways that are distracting from their real purpose, academic peer review and evaluation of academic quality. Faculty and administrators are ill-equipped to assess institutional decision-making, and indeed, as Hank's already indicated, there's an inherent conflict of interest when faculty and administrators are overseeing or substituting their views to a board which is legally responsible for the big picture. And I think it's especially bad when the department's response is to say, sorry, we don't have any authority to review accreditors' decisions outside a limited number of stated criteria. And yes, that is what the Department of Education has said. Back in December 2012, this was the response we received to a complaint we filed against the Southern Association of Colleges and Schools for exceeding its rightful authority in placing the University of Virginia on warning. This response from the Department of Ed should be profoundly troubling to Congress and to all of us in a democratic society, since the gatekeepers, who were established to protect the public, in fact have been given unbridled authority to interfere in the decision-making of our institutions in ways that undermine their autonomy and their agility, that are absolutely necessary in the very competitive, very dynamic landscape that we find today. That's why ACTA was pleased recently to file an amicus brief in the Fourth Circuit Court of Appeals, arguing that the Higher Education Act has established an unconstitutional delegation to a private and very conflicted body composed of education industry stakeholders. Under the existing HEA, accreditors have the sole authority to set standards, and they are given a veritable blank check, a phrase that I will take from Hank Brown, to adopt standards outside the express provisions of the law. Congress must stop this. Only when accreditors cease being gatekeepers and return to their voluntary peer review role will we be able to have the transparency and choice that we need. Briefly, I'd like to just quote from a brand new report called Governance for a New Era, signed by a blue chip crowd of 22 people, including Hank Brown and Chairman Benno Schmidt. And I think it's interesting in this report, they specifically point out that the accreditation process has increasingly imposed immense financial burdens in time and labor with little evidence of comparable return. And then they say it is time to consider cutting the link between accreditors and federal financial aid so that accreditors may rightly return to their role as peer reviewers. That, in fact, is what the American Council of Trustees and Alumni has called upon, and it also is part of the proposal that Arthur Rothkopf and I submitted as an alternative before the National Advisory Committee of Institutional Quality and Integrity. This would be a system that would also call for the end of regional monopolies. It would be market-based. It would require accreditors to show financial stability through an audited financial statement annually, something that it does not now do, or that it does do now. It would, in turn, require a range of important metrics on academic performance, such as student repayment rates, student graduation rates, demographic success, performance on a nationally normed exam. I believe that consumers can make up their own mind, and that is why we are recommending this delinked system to replace the so-called quality assurance system that we have now. Where is the quality protection? Under this system, we have consumer information and a guarantee of financial stability. It will protect students from fraud and mismanagement, and it will allow the Department of Education to be an appropriate night watchman with real information, able to put sanctions in place if our institutions have not been honest in their representation of their financial and academic well-being. If that's not good enough, there are some tweaks. Let's have Congress establish a threshold below which Title IV will not be given. Or let's insist that the schools show student learning gains through a nationally normed test. That would allow schools which are actually providing educational quality to avoid the burdensome existing accreditation system and provide an escape valve for low-risk institutions. Let's make this a pilot and give institutions an alternative right away. LEED certification in the architecture business has shown the currency of solid, rigorous, voluntary assessments by independent third parties. If set free from their gatekeeping role, academic peer reviewers could do the same. Thank you.
Thank you,
Ann.
Neil?
Thank you, all of you, especially Lindsay and Heritage, for asking me over here today. I was going to say I'm probably going to disappoint Lindsay and Heritage, but maybe I won't because we were talking earlier and I know what my job is wherever I go. What I was going to tell you is I don't care about accreditation. And of course, that's a problem, right? Because today is about accreditation. But of course, that's not really true. I do care about accreditation. But as Hank and Ann have already talked about, mainly I'm concerned about it because it's sort of simultaneously been rendered kind of too powerful and then not powerful enough. So to really compete for federal funds, which, let's face it, are absolutely essential in the current higher education system, schools have to get accredited. But there is, I think, a lot of the federal government sort of telling accreditors what they have to do. So you have these accreditors that have this very powerful gatekeeping role. Simultaneously, there's a lot of control over them. So the reason I say I don't care about accreditation is that accreditation is clearly not the root problem in higher education. The root problem is federal spending on college, especially through student aid. It's very big, but I think that we'd find that if we were even smaller, we'd continue to have the problem of top-down controls that go on to colleges, currently largely through accreditation, but in the absence of accreditation would come right from Washington. I wanted to just give you a sense for how big the federal spending is. Again, I don't think the size is really all that important, but ultimately in 1970, total federal aid, if you include grants, the total amount of federal loans, tax credits, et cetera, in 2012 dollars, was about $19 billion. By 1995, it had grown to $52 billion. And by 2012, it had hit $170 billion. That, of course, is a lot of money in the aggregate. On a per pupil or full-time equivalent pupil basis, it went from $3,143 in 1990 to $9,445 in 2012. Clearly, this is a lot of money. Then if you add also federal spending on research and things like that, which is usually linked to a school being accredited if they want to get that, you're talking about well over $200 billion, according to the latest federal statistics. So that is a very big investment. And the fact of the matter is, I think if you look historically, if you think logically about this, as long as the federal government spends on education, and they spend a lot, but even if they spend less, they are going to dictate terms. You all know, he who pays the piper calls the tune. And it's currently in higher education that they do that largely through accreditors. And as Hank and Ann have talked, the gatekeeping role, the sort of infamous gatekeeping role, depending on where you sit here. And the fact of the matter, again, is almost every school is dependent on this. And of course they're dependent on it because other schools are using these huge amounts of money. They're using it to supply amenities, offices, nicer dorms, things like that. And if you want to compete for students, you have to do the same. So then the question is, well, what if the accreditation requirement in order to access this money were eliminated? And I would suggest you shouldn't expect any sort of significant improvement in the ability of colleges to do their job, or even more importantly, to constrain costs, inefficiencies, things like that. I think what you'll see fairly quickly is the federal government would just directly fill in the roles that they currently use accreditors for. Now, one proposal that, for instance, is along this line has come from Senator Lee, which would say, look, states should have the ability to say, we will accredit colleges, schools that operate in our states. And this is based on the right idea, you know, the sort of federalist idea, where we have laboratories of democracies, where states can try different things, see what works. If it doesn't work, other states don't have to do the same thing. And this is competitive federalism. There's already, though, something to be concerned about. If you look at that bill, it says in order for a state to do this, it has to get approval of the Secretary of Education. Why is that? Because the federal money is connected to this. And I think that if you can think how politics works, I think you can look historically, and I think the first thing you think is if we have state accreditors, the first time that something bad that really grabbed headlines happened at a state-accredited school, you would see the federal government, people in Congress say, okay, we can't let this happen again. People are outraged by it. Now we have to have rules and regulations about what states have to put in their accreditation requirements. If you continue to see bad outcomes, for instance, the very poor completion rates that we currently suffer from in higher education, you'd again see the federal government say, okay, if this continues to show up in states, we have to tell the states you have to use X, Y, and Z measure. In other words, you would continue to see lots of top-down controls. It just wouldn't come through accreditors. And if you really want to get a sense for this, look at K-12 education. K-12 education, the federal government doesn't say, well, we're going to say your school has to be accredited and we'll just leave it to accreditors to make most of the decisions. It says if you want federal money, that you have to follow lots of rules and regulations. And you can see the progression of this from 1965. That's the first year you had the Elementary and Secondary Education Act. First year you have the Higher Education Act. For about the first 20 years, what the federal government said is, look, this federal money is about just supplying or trying to equalize resources for low-income schools and districts to higher-income schools and districts. Eventually, the public started to say, well, what are we getting for all this money we spend? And the federal government, I think, with good intentions, started to say actually in the late 80s, but ramped up through the 90s, culminating in the No Child Left Behind Act, said, okay, well now states, if you want this money, first you have to have standards and tests and in a band of different grades. Then under No Child Left Behind said, okay, every year, grades 3 through 8, once in high school, you have to have the standards, you have to have the tests, you have to disaggregate scores to subsets of children. You have to get everybody to something called proficiency by 2014, and you have to make progress every year toward that goal. That was a huge increase in federal control. Without the accreditation middleman, it's still huge increases in control. And then any of you certainly who know Heritage, if you're familiar with Cato, you've heard the term Common Core. Now the federal government is essentially saying, well, look, we've seen states not do what we want under No Child Left Behind. We have still bad outcomes. They define proficiency at very low levels. And the federal government said, look, through Race to the Top, through waivers out of No Child Left Behind, we are going to de facto almost require states to have one set of standards, the Common Core. There are a couple of outs there, but it's quite clear. The federal government has been pushing the Common Core, one curriculum. Why? Because they found that states were setting low standards, different standards, and the federal government said, if we're spending money on this, we have to control it. And you'd see the same thing, I think, if we eliminated accreditors. And notably, as a percentage of overall spending, the federal investment in K through 12 is much smaller than it is in higher ed. Another thing people are hoping will work is disruptive innovation, just this idea that someone will come up with these very low-cost, generally computer-driven, doesn't have to be based on the internet, but generally low-cost, very broad ways of delivering higher education. I think there's certainly some potential there. That you could go online, access these courses, get some sort of certification, say you know certain skills or skills and abilities, and that could change higher education. Right now, though, I don't see that there's evidence we could say comfortably that that is definitely happening. One big problem is often these online courses, you can't get credit, and if you can get credit, they don't culminate in a diploma, something tangible that you can hand people. We're moving in that direction. But I don't know that we can say we're definitely going that way by any stretch. And the other problem is, after you have these models start to really come on, start to gain market share, will they start to say, well, you know how much more money we can make if we started to say you can get student aid to come here, and they started to price based on student aid? You could very easily see what are now low-cost alternatives, saying we can make a lot more money, we could be a lot more competitive if we accept this money. But if you accept the money, you accept the rules. So I don't think we can comfortably say that that is going to prevent the federal government from taking over if we eliminate accreditation. So what's the answer? Well, my job is I don't worry about politics or anything. I get to say whatever I want, which is really easy, you know, because I can just go back to the think tank and nobody cares what I say. But we have to phase out student aid. We have to phase out student aid because student aid is what connected to the rules, and you can make student aid much smaller. And as we've seen in K through 12, even smaller percentages of your outlay coming from the federal government still carries federal rules. Now, of course, there are all sorts of other reasons to phase out student aid. It's very clear, I think, and there's a lot of research supports, that this is a major driver of tuition inflation, that it causes people to be less concerned about what they're buying. You know, am I buying the education I want, or am I buying the education, and am I buying the recreation facilities, you know, that sometimes come complete with water parks and all sorts of other things that are just extraordinary when you think that they're in institutions of higher education. So there are numerous reasons to eliminate student aid, but one of them is then you could free up accreditation to do what I think, from what I'm hearing, everybody sort of agrees it's a good role for it. Voluntarily, to be a way for institutions to have quality control, to talk to peers, have something that's very collegial, where you can have yourself analyzed from the outside, but without all the pressure and regulations that come with being the gateway to student aid. And of course, schools could also skip accreditation if they don't think that that's a good external evaluation of their product. And we already have ways to do that. People don't like U.S. News ratings. There are problems with it. But that's a national way to assess colleges that actually, if you read it, can give you lots of useful information on completion rates and debt and things like that. But if you don't like that, you can use the Forbes ratings. The Forbes ratings looks at lots of different criteria. So you can choose among these sort of national standards and assessment of quality. So accreditation, I said I didn't care, but of course accreditation, especially in the gatekeeping role, is definitely a problem, but it's really a symptom of the overall disease, and that disease is government funding, government aid, and if we want to fix the problems that come from it, it has to be eradicated. Thank you.
Great, thank you. So I'll take a point of moderator privilege and just point out that the proposal, the Lee proposal that's on the table would allow states to choose who can accredit, not actually directly accredit. Mm-hmm. You don't know if that changes your calculus at all. But so quick question for each of the panelists. Can you talk just briefly, what would the impact either of delinking accreditation or entirely getting the feds out of the their federal role, for lack of a better word, in higher ed right now, what would the impact for the student be if either of those scenarios took place?
Well, I guess I'll go first since I went on the extreme side of that. I should first of all say it's important that I note or that I frame this as phase out. So clearly you can't eliminate federal aid, federal involvement tomorrow. Sometimes people think I'm saying just get rid of it. The fact of the matter is federal aid is baked into the price that everybody confronts. So what has to happen is it's phased out. But in the phasing out, what I think you'd see for students is, first of all, prices would become more rational and more transparent. Right now, you know, a private college seems very expensive until you eventually factor in what kind of aid you're going to get. But that's a big problem if you don't know what the aid is going to be. So I think it would ultimately end up being a lot more affordable for most people. I don't think you'd have a problem of lack of access, because if someone had demonstrated the ability to do college-level work in a field that's in demand, lenders will have high incentive to work with that person. But I do think you'll see fewer people going to college in pursuit of a degree, because that changing the funding will incentivize people looking for more efficient ways to get the education they need and a way of signaling that they have it. So ultimately, I think it'll be better for students if we were to eliminate that. But it's got to be done gradually.
Specifically delinking, I think it goes to the heart of who runs a university. And here we're talking primarily, I think, on the impact would be public universities. If you think about the University of Virginia, chartered by the state of Virginia, trustees appointed by the governor, many states' legislators end up having a ratification role with it. We probably think about those states as being in charge of those universities, that is, providing governance for those universities. The reality of the system we have now is that the accreditors have responsibility, let me change that word, have the ability to control those universities. How so? The federal assistance, student aid, loans, and so on, Pell Grants, etc., ends up being linked to accreditors signing off on the university. Without it, continuation of the university would be very difficult for most circumstances. So for most universities or colleges, they're in a circumstance where they have to do what the accreditors say. The federal statute that is now in place with regard to accreditation places no limit on what the accreditors can look at. So the system that we have now puts in charge of the university in terms of decision-making, if they choose to do it, the accreditors, rather than the state government or the governor or the trustees. We have a group of people who don't pay the bills who end up having the power to make the decisions. Delinking would put the states back in charge of their own institutions that they chartered and that they largely fund, and that which their state law says they direct. That delinking would put states back in charge, in effect.
Well, I'll certainly second what Hank said, and I just want to add that I think students would be so much better off under a delinking system. Right now, accreditation is opaque, it's captive to the insiders, and it dupes families and students. They think when they go to an accredited institution that they're going to an institution that's offering them value. And we know that there, if we look at the vast expanse of colleges and universities that are accredited, they go from some that have single-digit graduation rates to some that have 97 or 98% graduation rates. So the moniker or the imprimatur of accreditation, frankly, is duping and disserving consumers and families who think that it means something. If we delink as proposed, we will be able to ensure the financial responsibility of the institution, so that student and that family will be protected. We'll give them consumer information in a set group of metrics that can be compared apples to apples so that they will actually have data on student performance that they don't now have. And I think ultimately it will affect the affordability because Michigan, Princeton, places like this, which are certainly not suffering from a lack of resources, have themselves complained about how they're spending millions of dollars dealing with this accreditation regime, which then provides very little value. So I think it'll affect affordability down the road. It'll give people more information and empower consumers to make intelligent choices, which they can't really do now under the current accreditation system.
Great. Hey, we'd love to open it up for questions. If you'll just raise your hand and wait for the mic to come your way since we're recording this. Yes, sir.
Hello, Blake Neff from the Daily Caller News Foundation. I guess what comes to mind for me is if the problem with accreditation is that they have too much stuff that they can look into, and I assume it's related, it costs a lot for them to comply with the accrediting regimes, why do we need such a major reform like delinking when it seems to me like what we could just do is pass a series of restrictions on what accrediting agencies can actually look at, so that we can try to tailor more specifically to the academic concerns they have, rather than all the other stuff that they're looking at?
Personally, I think there's some merit in that idea, that is, focusing accreditation on academic quality rather than governance matters. So the University of Hawaii, who were warned when they had a system for picking the athletic directors that the accreditors didn't like, would be in a position where they could actually pick an athletic director without having the accreditors get involved in that. So I think that kind of guidance would be helpful. Focus them on academic quality, not in terms of the governance matters that the states have, a reasonable responsibility to do and are in the best place to do it. So that, to me, is a step forward. You still have a challenge. Will the accreditors, with that internal conflict of interest, really look at academic quality? I think most observers, having looked at the current accreditation system, would say that that it has not done a good job, and perhaps some would say haven't scratched the surface in terms of examining academic quality. So I think you still have that problem, but restricting them from the wide range of governance matters would be enormously helpful.
Do you want to add anything to that,
Ian? I certainly agree. I think you still have the captive problem in that you have these membership organizations that do tend to push an agenda. And I think every time we get near higher education reauthorization, there's a chorus that says, oh, we're going to limit here, and the accreditors realize that they've overstretched their bounds. They're now getting it their act together, and we don't need to worry. They're going to go back to what they really should have been doing, educational quality. And we tend to hear that every time we get near reauthorization, and I'm somewhat skeptical. And I think, as I look at the terrain, I mean, 1965, the Higher Education Act, which is what we're still pretty much dealing with. Admittedly, there have been changes since 65. But if you think about higher education in 1965 and the landscape we have now, which is fertile and bringing forth a range of options and opportunities, I think we want to have a structure that allows more flowers to bloom, more providers, different courses, unbundling. I mean, I think we really need to rethink higher education in light of the vast changes that have occurred over the last 40 or 50 years, which is why I think a more drastic, a more radical look at the Act in order to catch up with where we are now would be beneficial to everybody.
The only thing I'd say is you have to be very careful when you talk about, you should have the accreditors or the federal government or anyone else say, well, we will measure quality, because there are actually going to be lots of disagreements about quality. Even if you talk about, well, you have a nationally normed test for a college, of course, within a college are all sorts of different programs. Different people start at different levels of knowledge and all sorts of things. And one of the great strengths of our higher education system is there is still, especially relative to K-12, a whole lot of diversity in what the schools are, what their mission is, what they offer, which, you know, areas of study they specialize in. And so I would fear, one, that if there were still any federal connection, that you would have or even accreditors, you would have some great limit put on what the measure is of quality that would let you access that money. And the last thing we want to do is have move higher ed in the K-12 direction of saying, well, we're just going to have one measure that really determines whether or not you can access this money, one measure that says whether you're quality or not.
Could I comment on that? I think you raise a very good point. Quality is is often like beauty. It's in the eye of the beholder. One of the options that I think Congress is looking at and that I hope they will consider is not mandating what is quality, but requiring some basic disclosures so students have the ability and parents have the ability to make their own evaluation. So one option would be to control quality from the central government, but another option would be simply to require disclosure of a variety of factors that are critical in making a decision. That kind of disclosure leaves the decision then up to the consumer.
Yes, sir.
Al Klein, Accuracy in Academia. Spinning off the senator's repeated references to jobs, does post-graduation employment ever factor into accreditators' ratings, even as an afterthought?
I've seen very few accreditations that looked at that factor. It strikes me that your employability and your success in finding a job is clearly a factor that students, potential students, and families would be interested in. If Congress decides to go the route of disclosure, it seems to me that would have real value.
Yes, sir, in the middle.
Before the question and answer section, I'm Chris Denhart, Center for College Affordability and Productivity. Senator Brown mentioned state governance, which reminds me of like state appropriations and sort of the state's role in funding higher ed. And oftentimes, state appropriation decline is blamed for a rise in tuition, which, agree or not, whatever, it is sort of contributed to that. So my question is, how much does this federal aid or appropriation just crowd out state funding? And if we were to reduce or eliminate this federal funding, how much would that lead to an increase in state funding and therefore state control of these so-called state colleges?
If you permit me, let me share a story with you. The last week I was in the Senate, I took the elevator down with Mark Hatfield from our office in the Hart building down to the floor. We were going over for a vote, and Mark said, "What are you going to be doing?" And I told him that I planned to teach at the University of Denver. We talked a little about universities. Mark, as you, some of you may know, taught at the collegiate level before he got into political office and I think was a governor, if I remember right, before he ran for the Senate. At any rate, in describing the world of academia just after the war in the late 40s, he noted that he taught 5 3-hour courses a semester, in addition to being the assistant dean of men, in addition to other service. Now you would find at most prestigious universities, senior tenured faculty teaching 1 to 2 courses a semester instead of 5 courses a semester. Now, obviously we perhaps are more rigorous in what we demand in the way of research and writing. And service. That probably varies very much by campuses. So some would have rigorous demands there, some would not have ones at all. But one obvious documentable change that's taken place since the late 40s is a dramatic drop in the teaching productivity. Not suggesting the faculty don't work hard. Some work very hard. Some are, like other professions, there's a wide variety of how hard people work. but there is a clear drop in teaching productivity. And that factor is come because of the availability of money and the concern over improving quality at institutions, or at least perceived quality of institutions. But if you get into a question of what will lower the cost of higher education, you can't help but take notice that one of the major factors has been the drop in teaching productivity and the failure to adopt as quickly as other parts of the economy towards using the technology that is now available.
I think that was a very diplomatic answer on variance and teacher quality. I would note, too, that Jay Green at the University of Arkansas has done a lot of work on administrative bloat. Do you have that on?
Yeah, I think that's a good point about the states. And I think one of the things that you see, especially if you were to phase out federal involvement, is you may see some increase in state spending, but there's got to be a natural limit because, unlike the federal government, states can't just print money when they want to spend more of it. And I think that, like Senator Brown said, that will, I think, lead to much greater efficiencies. And that's, you know, ultimately what we should want. I probably should say something on the idea of transparency or disclosure of information about a school as being an important way to control costs. I think we need to be very clear that much of the data that we want the federal government to require is already out there, and in large extent it seems to be ignored. So you can look at the BLS data and see what psychology majors earn, or psychologists, and you can see that's probably not a good major to undertake, especially take on a lot of debt, and yet we have thousands and thousands of people who do it every year. The data is easy to find. I've searched for it. It's not hard. You can look at pay scale data and see which areas are not remunerative, which ones you don't want to take on big debt for, and people continue to do that. In large part, I think it's because somebody will happily give you the money without any scrutiny about what you're doing and where you're doing it. And that's the federal government. We'll give you a loan, as long as you're accredited. Doesn't matter which institution you go to or what you major in or essentially what your academic background is. And so disclosure, I don't think there's a lot of evidence that's actually going to do much to improve the situation. It may be a little better than what we have now, but there's no evidence that I've seen that it's going to make a big difference.
Could I add, you were very kind in the way you phrased your observation. I should not let it pass without noting that my own personal perception is that there is an enormous opportunity for an increase in productivity by reducing overhead in most universities. And let me give you an example. The first university I headed was the University of Northern Colorado. They had a strong reputation for performing arts and education, preparing teachers. Over the course of 4 years, I reduced the number of administrators by over 100. This was at the same time we grew enrollment. So with more students, we had more than 100 fewer administrators. In my view, I think it's reasonably shared, it operated better with fewer administrators. Over that period of time, we reduced overhead by $7 million a year and transferred that funding into limiting tuition increases, but also improving what we provided in the way of instruction in academic scope. That kind of discipline that happens in the private sector because of competition seldom happens in higher education. It does happen, but it's not particularly commonplace, nor is it easily done, and so on. But it's essential if we're going to have a productive higher education in this country. And all you have to do is compare the number of administrators and the cost of administration now with what it was in years past. One other observation. It is very easy, if you want to go to the national data that's available and look at the administrative cost and the administrative FTE, the number of people at various institutions that are similar to yours. And from that conclude whether or not you have more administration or less than they do and look at the exact details of it. What's the point? The point is that very few states in the nation ever bothered to look at the numbers. Very few boards of trustees look at the numbers. Let me be more specific. Trustees seldom know the data is there and seldom know where their institution stands on it and seldom insist on the administrative efficiencies that they should. And until we change that, until we allow institutions to have a better, a more complete role in managing them, you're not going to have the productivity that you should.
Lindsay, can I just add too? I mean, and accreditation, I think it's fair to say, has been something that looked at enhancing resources and adding on. It's not been a process that encourages looking at greater productivity and ways to save money. And so I just want to add on one additional metric that trustees can and should be focusing on, which is, again, utilizing their buildings better. I know we've been all watching the concern about sexual assault and what we're seeing on college campuses. And again, this is an area where trustees can be very engaged. How many of us know students that start their school day on Tuesday and end it on Thursday afternoon? And with trustees and academic leaders insisting on 5 days a week or 6 days a week, we'd get greater productivity. We'd get students through much faster than they do now because they're now spending 4, 5, and 6 years because they don't have to go to school or they can't get the courses they need. I mean, there are any number of ways that academic leadership, if it focuses on these kinds of metrics that matter, which would be metrics that could be provided in a delinked system which allows consumer information, this is a way that we can actually get our institutions to go back to a more affordable education that's focused on education rather than the amenities that Lindsay mentioned and that we've also heard about.
I really enjoyed those Tuesday through Thursday days, Anne. Yes, ma'am.
Sounds like Congress.
Oh, they're not that bad.
They can't get that low. Speaking of Congress, I'm a congressional correspondent with the Hispanic Outlook on Higher Education, so I'm curious about where the politics of all this is. I know there's been a number of hearings on reforming accreditation, and there is some bipartisan support for various ideas. How is that looking for 2015, and especially if the Senate changes to Republican dominance? How do you see that happening next year when the Higher Ed Authorization Act is going to come up for review?
I'm going to defer to the senator.
Don't look at me.
My impression is that there's bipartisan interest in this issue. Senator Bennett from Colorado, for example, on the Democratic side, is working on putting together a bill that would provide, I think, a real step forward. I know Senator Lamar Alexander has been interested in this for a long time. So I think there's a good chance you'll see bipartisan interest in this as you go forward. So much of it is good common sense when you look at it. I think of your question. One of the things I ran into at the University of Colorado, an institution with very high standards. So it was a great privilege to be there. But one of the questions I had for our business school was, they couldn't, you know, we had twice as many people apply to transfer to the business school as they had openings. And so I naturally inquired, well, why don't you let more of them in? If people want that discipline, why don't you allow them? Well, they said, we just don't have the classrooms. I said, well, send me a breakout of your utilization of the classrooms. Well, they sent me a utilization, and it was a 99% utilization of the classrooms. So one day on campus, I walked through the business school. It happened to be a Friday, and there wasn't anybody there. And no one was in the classrooms. So I took the report and went back to him, and I said, what's going on here? You said that it was 100% used, and nobody's there. He said, oh, well, the way we keep our records is if the classroom is open for students to study in, we call that utilized for instruction. Well, obviously, we totally changed the system, and they now are able to make much better use of the classroom. They even have classes on Friday. The faculty who did a lot of consulting found that a hideous crime, but the reality is you have an enormous potential for increased productivity on campuses with good administration. And as we think about this issue, we shouldn't be thinking of ways to prohibit people from becoming productive. And that's what we've done with the current accreditation system. If you think about accreditation and why there's a bipartisan interest in improving it, it's because we have not improved productivity the way we should, and it's cost everybody. So it's why I think it's a bipartisan issue.
Time for one or two more questions. Yes, sir.
Hi, Kenneth from the Heritage Foundation intern. Is it sustainable for a business to not accept any federal funds at all, or are colleges like Hillsdale College an anomaly? And secondly, if that is a possibility for businesses to go without any federal funds, is that a different way, a different approach to phase out this sort of accreditation, kind of discredit accreditation sort of approach?
Well, since that's kind of related to, I guess, what I said, my first thought is that Hillsdale, I think you only have three colleges that don't accept money, at least, you know, undergraduate degree colleges. So it's Hillsdale, Grove City, and I think Christendom College are the only ones that don't take it. And my suspicion is that they are able to sustain that because it's a very, very small niche market. We are the three people or schools that don't take this money. So please donate to us if you like that. I suspect if you had a whole lot of other colleges try that, they wouldn't be able to compete with the ones that do take federal money and do set up all these amenities, the 3 days a week of classes and things like that. I would also say I'm skeptical that even absent accreditation, if federal money were still there, that you would see many schools find deficiencies. And there's some good research shows that a lot of people, when they're choosing a college, unless they're the highest performing academically, they're choosing based on amenities and lots of, you know, things that aren't about education. And so long as that's the case, and especially if those are decisions are abetted by the fact they're using third-party money in many cases, then I don't know that you'll see a whole lot of efficiencies added, even if you get rid of accreditation. And the other thing, I guess, is about these kind of disruptive technologies and disruptive schools and whether or not you could have MOOCs and things like that provide the same level of education, or at least the credential that you want, at drastically lower prices to the point where people wouldn't feel a need to use aid. I think that theoretically that's possible, but I wouldn't want to say we can count on that because we just haven't seen it so far. And I do worry a great deal that a lot of these disruptive operators will say, well, look, we could end up making a lot more money if we let people bring federal aid with them. And so they would end up sort of being co-opted and their prices would go up because they can raise them. And that's often, I think, what it comes down to is people who supply education will do whatever they can that they think is best for them, and that is usually bringing in as much money as you can.
I agree that I think it's very hard for most schools to do without Title IV money in the current context. There are some explorations, I think, right now of some private lending platforms that might be available. And one other thing that is entirely disruptive, which I think continues to be very intriguing, is there is the CLA Plus, which allows a student to show whether or not he or she has certain critical thinking skills. And it's conceivable that someone could train him or herself through MOOCs or the teaching company or whatever and take this CLA Plus, show critical thinking skills, and then present that to an employer. So it's critical that the employer be receptive to it. But if we really wanted to think about a very disruptive model at a very low cost, it is out there, and all we need to do is get the employer community receptive to these, and then I think our colleges and universities that are on the traditional model may see some real competition and have to rethink what they're doing.
I'm so glad you brought that up. That is a big part of the puzzle, I think, is getting employers receptive to this, to not looking at the bachelor's degree as a proxy for employability and actually looking at the skill sets that students are bringing. Any final questions? Great. Well, please join me in, go ahead, real quick.
And this is for the whole panel. Do you guys give any credence to the theory of reverse causation in the college market, where more conscientious, more intelligent students are the ones who get BAs, and that's why BAs serve as a useful signal in the labor market?
Well, I'll say a little about that. I think that may have been sort of the impetus for this, is that you had people who already had great skills, intelligence, abilities, and they were people getting bachelor's degrees. And then I think politically people said, well, we need to get more people bachelor's degrees, because there's this correlation, not necessarily a cause, between having a degree and your outcome. I think now, though, if you look at degrees and you look what many different types of degrees are actually earning you, the bachelor's degree is no longer a great way to guarantee that you have a good income. And I don't think it's nearly as correlated with underlying student ability as it used to be. Of course, you've got to be very careful, because lots of different degrees are very different. So the evidence suggests lots of engineering majors are heavily remunerative, and you probably actually learn a lot in college for those that you couldn't get outside of it, or at least not easily. So you also have to differentiate a lot. But in general, I think that you can see that most of the evidence suggests that bachelor's degree has been heavily devalued, and it's no longer even a very good signal of basic attributes somebody might already have before they get that degree.
Anything to add to that? I think that's absolutely right. And if we look at rampant grade inflation, which Hank is already referring to, and I wouldn't say you just have to be a warm body to get a BA, but in many instances, I think that we have found that very little work is required. And Academically Adrift, which we've seen a new version come out just recently from Richard Arum and Josipa Roxa, again, is looking at college graduates and their cognitive learning gain. And what it's finding, and what the Department of Ed has found with its National Assessment of Adult Literacy, are college graduates who aren't even proficient. They can't compare the cost of can't compare editorials, they can't compute the cost of office goods. These are people with BAs. So I don't, while I'd love to agree with you, I don't think that's the case.
Great. Well, please join me in thanking all of our panelists.